today on LifePoint.
Today is going to be the greatest day of your life.
to come on LifePoint.
Every child is special. Every human being has a destiny that God has set forth, regardless of the circumstances by which they are conceived.
Before you, you silence the boast of sin and shame. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. Silence of boast and sin and pain. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal.
See my sin.
bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Thank you for joining us today on LifePoint. On today's program, Pastor Kevin's going to take a break from his series on end time events to bring you a very special Mother's Day message. Let's give a listen.
Welcome today to LifePoint Online, or as we've been calling it, Church at Home. If you've been watching, we've been in this series about when will Jesus return? And we've been learning that the Bible clearly teaches when Jesus will come back. There is no ambiguity. There is no confusion if we dare just to take what the Bible says and dare to believe what it says. We can learn a lot. But today we're going to take a break from that and talk about mothers on this Mother's Day. We'll pick back up next week and we'll talk about the Antichrist. Mother-in-laws. I'm kidding. That's just stereotypical humor. I got to tell you, I am a blessed man. Both my mother and my mother-in-law are good, godly women that pray for me and my family on a regular basis. And I thank God for the gift of both my mom and my mother-in-law. But take your Bibles in with me today. And I want to talk about the greatest mom who ever lived. Now, because my mom is not in the Bible, we're going to talk about another mom. We're going to talk about the mother of Jesus, Mary. And so in John chapter 2, we're going to take a look at a passage of scripture here this morning. John chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. And it's a very well-known passage of scripture, and we're going to take a look at it this morning. Here we go. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." This, the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed in Cana of Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. Let's bow your heads and hearts with me, would you please? Heavenly Father, we come before you this day thanking you for the gift of mothers. And wherever we find that motherly love, we are blessed, and they are gifts to us. We just ask, Lord, that you would open up our hearts to hear what you have for us today. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And we all said, wherever we're watching, all around the world, amen. Let me just set the cultural context for this passage of Scripture. In Jesus' day, in this time in which we're reading here, a wedding and the feast that followed, or as we would call it, the reception, could last up to a week. And it was the responsibility of the family throwing the feast to take care of all of the fixins, as they say down south. It was an embarrassment if they ran short of any kind of supply. Nowhere in these times was there ever a a BYOW, bring your own wine. you didn't show up to a party with your own couple of boxes from BevMo or Costco or wherever you go. You did not bring your own. It was a responsibility of the wedding planner and the host to make sure that every bit of these plans were carried out in full. No one lacked anything. To do so would be a major party faux pas. So understand that this is a big deal, that they ran out of something to drink. So this is actually kind of a chaotic scene, so to speak. And Jesus' mother was, Mary, was in the right frame of mind to try to fix the situation. So there's three things I see in this passage of Scripture that I want us to look at this morning is this. Number one is that Mary knew that Jesus was special and encouraged him to do great things. One characteristic of a godly mother is to help their children see their gifts and to see that they are encouraged to use them. A godly mother knows what giftings that their children have. Now, it helps when, for Mary's sake, that an angel of the Lord visits her when she's a teenager and lets her know that, oh, by the way, you're going to be impregnated with the Son of God and you're going to be responsible for carrying the Savior and birthing him into this world, and that he's coming into this life to give himself up as a ransom for many. Mary had that prophetic word, and so she had a sensibility of a complete understanding of what Jesus' role was and his destiny. But we don't always get that role. We don't always get that blessing. We don't always get that. We don't have the blessing to have that foreknowledge, if you will. But a mother's instinct with their children, they know. They know that child. They know the tendencies. They see what makes that child tick, what makes that child move, what motivates that child. And a godly mother will, as the Bible says, train up a child in the way that they should go. And what that means is that passage is often misquoted. Training up a child in the way that they should go really means in the bents and tendencies and giftings that God has placed within each one. Every child is special. Every human being has a destiny that God has set forth, regardless of the circumstances by which they are conceived. That's why it bothers me to see so many children taken from this world before they're even born. Because we have no idea what the destinies lie within those children. Children are special. And a mother knows it. And a mother can see the giftings. And a mother will encourage her child to function in those gifts. Now, I can see the scene. And it's not too hard to imagine the setting, and as I gave you the cultural setting for the passage, that they run out of wine And some of the ladies are talking, and you know how it is. I mean, people are people. When a lot of people gather, the women kind of congregate to one side, the men kind of congregate to another side, and you know, men are talking about hunting and fishing and cars and that kind of stuff, and women are talking about other things, and it's just kind of the way human nature is. But I can imagine in this setting, the ladies are there together, and maybe one of the women there says to Mary, "Hey, Mary, go see if your son Jesus can do something." Because I'm sure that as he's being raised, Mary is telling the story that this is the Son of God. This is not of natural conception. This is immaculate. And people knew, and she, Mary especially, knew that Jesus was God in the flesh. Or Mary even might have said, you can't falter. She sees the situation, and out of concern for the people throwing the party, she goes over to Jesus and she tells her friends, I'll get the Son of God. He was the one the Bible says spoke and galaxies leapt into existence. And the Bible says that by him and through him, all things are created. So Mary, I mean, is probably figuring, hey, you're walking on the earth in a galaxy you created, and you made the grapes, and you made, why don't you do something about the wine situation? She goes to Jesus and she encourages him to function in that capacity to reach his fullness. But Jesus' response to her was this, that it's not my time. The second thing I notice is this, that Mary knew when to release Jesus into his destiny. Mary says when she walks up to Jesus and asks him to do something about the lack of wine, and Jesus says, "Woman, why do you bother me with this? It's not my time yet." Jesus knew at that moment, this is the moment I need to back off and release him into his own authority, into his destiny, what he is, what he knows is best to do. And there comes a time when every parent, every mother, and every father, especially mothers, they need to release them, release your children. Some of you, your kids are 50 years old, and you still got a grip on them. You at some point, God gives them to you to raise, and then you got to give them right back to him. You've got to release them. You've got to say, you know what? You're on your own. I'm here to support you. I'm here to give you advice, but you need to function in the destiny God's called you to be. And she knew that at that moment, that's the time I need to say, enough. I'm backing out. And she wisely says to the servants, I'm not going to tell you what to do. He's going to, whatever he tells you to do, that's what you need to do. At that moment, I believe Mary knew, this is the time that I've got to release Jesus. My influence over him has come to an end. The Bible says that for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother. Now, he doesn't leave necessarily as far as have nothing to do with it. It's the principle of leaving and cleaving, that you leave one family's influence and you start your own family's traditions and ways of doing things. So often marriages are crumbling or they're not as strong as they could be because a husband is still tied back to his mom or dad and doesn't leave the sphere of influence and cleaves to his wife. And those two confidently start out with the authority that they have as a husband and wife to becoming one. It's a leave and cleave issue many times when I do counseling is when you look at the influence of the family into the new family structure. If you're meddling in your children's life, let them go. Stand back. It's too late now to try to do something you should have done when they were two or three. You need to trust God. What your role, mom and dad, needs to be is to be on your knees praying for those young couples who are getting married and starting their own family, that they rely on God the way you relied on God. Mary knew that. She said, you know what? It's time for him to be thrust into his own destiny. The third thing that I see is this. is that Jesus honored his mother even when she clearly had made a mistake about timing. Jesus went ahead and covered her. It's one of the hardest things to do, human nature, is to cover somebody else's mistakes. Human nature is that we keep pointing them out. We've all been in situations where a coworker or somebody that was in your circle had an idiosyncrasy or some habit that they did, and so oftentimes the person leaves and goes and gets another job, and after the person's gone, you still talk about that person's shortcomings. The Bible says that love covers a multitude of sins. If there's one thing that God is, and Jesus came to represent God, is he's love. Love covers a multitude of sins. Jesus didn't yell at his mom, "Hey, leave me alone. Hey, listen, everybody, she's still trying to tell me what to do." He didn't do any of that. He corrected her. "Hey, listen, this isn't really my business, but because I'm sure that this is being talked about, I'm going to step in here and provide. And I'm going to cover some mistakes." Listen to me. Here's the principle that I pull out of this. The Bible says that we are to honor our fathers and mothers. And the scripture says that is the first commandment with a promise and a blessing of long life, and that God honors a culture of honor. You say, "Well, you don't know my mom or my dad. You don't know the mistakes. You don't know the abandonment. You don't know the pain. You don't know the overbearing, the helicopter parent." You can go and fill in the blank and add whatever it is, the issues that you've had with your parents. God says honor them some way. Maybe the way to honor them is just to stop talking about their shortcomings. Maybe that's the way to honor them. Maybe you had the disadvantage of having been abandoned, inconsistency. I don't know what you're going through, but I do know that God will bless you and he'll honor you if you seek to honor them. And maybe at a base level, the only way you know how to honor them is to not talk about their shortcomings. You forgive them. And you seek that advice and you seek that counsel and you seek that unconditional love that you sought after as a child. Maybe you find that in somebody else. Because if you're one of the ways you can have compassion on people is understand that if they had it, they would do it. And the reason why they didn't give it is possibly because they didn't have it to give, or they didn't know how, or it wasn't modeled for them. Honor your father and mother. The life point this morning is this: when you do it God's way, you get God's blessing. When you do it God's way, you get God's blessing. Now, I understand that sometimes it's hard to do it God's way when you don't have the equipping and you haven't had it modeled. But one of the things that the Bible says that pleases God, it says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. If you're in a situation today where you're hurting and you're frustrated and you're deep down, maybe you're angry at your mom or your dad or whatever the situation is, I just really feel impressed as I was studying for this and praying about this that there's some people out there today. Today is going to be the greatest day of your life, because there's going to be a releasing off of you when you just say, "Enough. I'm not going to carry this hurt and burden and pain any longer. I'm going to release them and forgive them. And I'm going to look forward instead of back. I'm gonna take the lessons I learned from when I was a girl or a boy, when I was growing up, and maybe you had a terrible upbringing. Those are all life lessons on how what not to do. And you can turn it around, and everything you saw as a negative, you can turn around and do the exact opposite. God can take anything and turn it into a blessing. And when we do it God's way, we get God's blessing. I want to challenge you right where you are today to stop and examine your hearts and ask yourself, is there something deep down, that there's, is there an area that needs to be released? Maybe you're a parent today and you realize that you're holding on and you're meddling too much into your kids' lives. The title of today's message is Moms, the Launching Pad for Destiny. Right now, you can go to your child, you can call up your kids and you can say, I am sorry for meddling in the affair, in your adult affairs. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to love you. I'm going to repent. I'm going to turn around. I'm going to stop doing that. Release your kids. God trusted them to you. You can trust God with them. You can be far more effective praying for them and asking God to speak to them than you trying to jump in the middle. Release them. Let them be launched into their destiny and watch them grow and flourish and watch the relationship change. It goes from being a parent to more being a friend. The problem in our culture today is that young parents want to be the friend of their child instead of the parent. You need to be the parent first, then you can be friend. Too often I see parents try to be their friend, and then when they see that lack of discipline and no friendship, that no parenting doesn't work, now they try to be the parent when you need to be the friend. When you do it God's way, you get God's blessing. Have a wonderful Mother's Day. God bless you, and we'll see you next time right here at LifePointCentralCoast.com.
Pastor Kevin, thank you for that message today that's encouraged our hearts. Let's just close in a word of prayer and solidify that word in our hearts today. Father, we thank you for this message. We thank you for this time that we've spent with you. I pray that you'll just touch every person that's watching this program today. There are those that are going through financial problems. There are those that are facing sickness. There are those that are facing various problems, discouragement. And I just speak in Jesus' name, a breakthrough and a turnaround for each person in Jesus' name. Would you just go to your phone and call the number on the screen? We'd love to pray with you, talk with you even more. God bless you.